This is Sankar from Freshworks. So a little bit of introduction about me. This is my first session in Ember. Thanks for the organizer before we start. Thanks for the organizer, Ashwin, Robin, Abhilash, Vasant. And if I didn't call out anybody, sorry for that. So my name is Sankar and I work here building chat for Freshworks. So what we are going to see today, finite state machine and Ember. So I'm sure we all know what is finite state machine. Should I go through what is finite state machine? We all pretty much know that, right? Okay. So this is the English finite state machine. What is state? What is transition? I'm going to skip that because I don't see any hand raising. So the buzzword is FSM. It's popularly known as FSM here. So bit of diagram, how state and transition works in a model of computing. Okay. So before we jump in, right? So where Ember uses finite state machine and why Ember router is so special. So 2-3 months back, Tom Dale, you all know, he's one of the steering committee, Ember steering committee person. He visited India and he was in LinkedIn office. And Gopal, you know, one of the organizer in India. So one of our organizer, Ashwin, connected with Gopal and he arranged for a call and we were discussing from here. So he was, you know, he was taken back when we asked like where you decided why to use state machine and how that, you know, revolutionary work came into Ember. And he was actually literally talking about that for at least 15 minutes. Before we start, I quickly touch that and come back. So till 2007, right, he was in Apple and he was working in Sprout Core team. And I also have some history because I worked in a Apple online store team where we were using coherent library, which is also porting, you know, Objective-C framework, COCO framework into, you know, JavaScript. And this Sprout Core team is also, you know, like we're building Mac apps inside Apple. And then it is also an open source framework. So it all, the story begin, you know, like for Tom Dale there, and he joined the Sprout Core team. And then when Yuda and Charles, who is the initial member, they came out and started this Sprout Core 2, which is actually the preliminary work for Ember. So he was, you know, fascinated while talking about that in that interview. So let me, you know, like, sorry for the detour, but I thought that that historical story would help us to understand how Ember router becomes special and what is or what are the different parts of it. So when they started Ember router in 2007, I guess that is what he says. The story goes like that, and he was mentioning, you know, we want to build something to make it client rendering. Till then, JavaScript is, you know, the whole page gets built in the backend and it comes to the browser and it just runs. So they wanted to make it client-side rendering, and that is when they actually went back to the academy and learned how the state charts work. And there were some white paper done by David Horrell and a couple of Davids. I didn't remember the second David last name. And they were actually exploring state charts, how state chart can actually fit in here, right? If you look at the URL transition, it is nothing but the serialization of states. So there is a parent path, and if you double click that, it goes into the child path. And if you move from one parent to another parent, it is a serialization of different states. You have to come out from the child to the parent, and then you have to go into the next parent. So they were thinking about this and they were trying to put it into the state chart. So what can make it more special or even help anybody to, you know, like better, you know, build a better client-side rendering application is the isolation part and the stitching part. So if you look at the URL transition exactly, if you look at the browser, you see it as one transition from URL A to URL B, but there can be, you know, series of states. So they decided they will isolate the URL transition and the data population so that the URL transition can be, you know, like done separately, and the data modeling or the data needed for the page rendering can be, you know, like done separately. So the isolation and the stitching part, which actually made it even more special. And one of the session, Michael was mentioning that Ember routing is so special. They built it, you know, it is a home ground solution, right? And in another session also, Raja, I think, mentioned about the, you know, Ember run loop. So that also I will touch probably here. So why FSM? So these are the reasons why we have to use FSM for routing. So it gives you the current context. You know where you are at the current state. And then there is a transition which happens, which can be made both, you know, linear and hierarchical. The reason we are making it linear, because as I said before in the previous slide, it is a serialization of states, right? So unless you make it linear and hierarchical, the actual transition will drop or lose the data or lose the context. So that is why they made it as linear and hierarchical. When I show you the URL path change and the route change, I will come back and touch this point again. Identifies the path to reach the target context. So you are in a current context and you are moving to a different context, right? And you need to know which path you can choose to actually reach there. So that is another reason why they have FSM, and replay is also possible. Say you are doing a transition and you want to abort it and you want to detour the user. Most of the people does this, right? You go visit a page. Now you identify that user is not logged in. Now you route them to the, you know, you don't stop doing the transition. You route it back to the login page and then you replay the existing route transition, which is maybe a home page or profile page or whatever. So replay is also possible. So these are the main core reasons why they have chosen, you know, like why I believe, at least, maybe, you know, like they did it for different reasons, but why I believe that why we need FSM. Yeah. So how Ember implemented it, right? So they have chosen the state chart path, and then the FSM concepts are well explained. Now, how we are going to implement it, right? In the two slides before, we were talking about the isolation and stitching part. So how we can implement it actually? So if you look at the URL is changing, and then based on the URL change, you have to manage route transitions. So I have four different points here to actually double click and see today. One is the browser session. So for a single page application, the session changes every time when you go from page A to page B. And then there is a history location API we already have, you all know, right? Every time there is a change in the URL, there needs to be a history, you know, change in the browser so that the browser forward and backward works seamlessly. Because we are thinking about this, you know, client-side rendering is not possible if you reload the page. Isn't it? You lose the state, you lose the context. And in 2007 or 8, when they were building this, that was one of the roadblocks for client-side rendering app, which is now single page application. So the history API will play a major role helping us building this. And then the hierarchical FSM, we also look at that, and the lifecycle hooks, which helps them to actually call the right callbacks at every state transition and manage to, you know, mount, unmount, bundle, load the data, and then, you know, render or destroy even. So let me start from here. The first point is session, right? So I'm just posting one of the product page here. So session is a page visit in a single page application. Let's talk, or let's think everything in the context of single page application framework. So every session is a page we should visit in SPA, and every page visit is a path chain. You can look at this, right? Teams, sponsors. So everything is a path change. And every path change is a route change inside Ember. So foo, there is a parent foo, and inside which we have a bar, which is the child page and child route, and which again have another child. So how, for every route change, there is a state change inside Ember. That's how the Ember implemented the routing framework. So let's take the same example, this foo bar bass. So first, when you see slash foo in the browser, the foo enters, which is the state for foo. And then when you go to slash bar, when the path change, it enters into the bar route. And then when you go into the child further, the bass entered. When you come out, it is, since I said hierarchical or linear, and it is a sequence of serialization of state change. First the bass exit, and then the foo, sorry, then the bar, and then finally the foo. So this is what I mention as hierarchical plus linear fashion. And every state change is a responsive, right? So for example, when a state change, there are series of custom activity that we have to do to manage to run the Ember effectively. So for which there are callbacks, but these callbacks are nothing but these different responsiveness that it provides today, right? When it unmounts the route, it will call the, deactivate of the route, or when it mounts the route, it calls the activate callback of the route, and initialize, you all know, construct, and call the render. Finally, the render will happen, and then the destroy. So here I am trying to connect the point mentioned by Raja. He said the destroy will happen at the last. So the run loop will actually, queue all these and then effectively handles that. Are you all with me? Sorry, so silent. So, okay. It's a bit of more English and, textual conversation than looking at images and understand. Okay. So now touched the states, right? Here we look at the history API, how it is going to actually help us to effectively implement this state transitions. So these are the functions. Have you seen these or implemented any of these in your application? Any analytic information you want to track or anything in your application? Have you used this before? Okay, no worries. So these are the four main functions that history, browser history, DOM API. So history provides push state, which is nothing but adding a new URL state to the browser, right? So if you look at this, these are the products under Freshworks, right? So if you go back, this is one state and this is another state. So which is exactly is called out here. So the push state is nothing but adding a history to the browser. Pop state is whenever you go backwards or there is a hash change, pop state will be triggered. The replay state is nothing but you don't want to maintain the history in the browser back and forward. So which means there is a path which you want to replace with another path so that when you hit back, the existing path is actually not there anymore. So that is the replay state API method, and the hash change is nothing but the hash change in the path. So instead of path change, you can do the hash change all as well. So history API provides this. What we have to do to build a simple router is just listen to these APIs and then, you know, manage to do the route transition. When you want to move to a new route, you can actually use the push state to push it. When you want to observe the change backwards or forward, you have to observe pop state and hash change. So pop state will do all path changes. Hash change will enable you to observe to the hash change. So I go back and connect the isolation and stitching part again. So the isolation is the URL path change is observed using the history location API. And every time the URL changes, they manages to run this, you know, like series of state transitions in the route and enable the route, you know, loading and unloading or mounting and unmounting. So I think we talked about hierarchical a couple of times. If it is only parent, it is jump from one parent to another parent. But if there is parent child, the hierarchical is, you know, like help us effectively implement it so that there will be no leakages, there will be no, you know, like states which get missed while, you know, doing the transition. So I just tried implementing a simple Glimmer component in Ember, and I tried adding the activate, deactivate, construct, and build destroy. These are the callbacks it calls whenever the URL changes. So if you look at this, okay, I will start this again. So organization have two child and products have, if you look at this, so it has one component and one parent route called the products. So the product enter state happens first, and then the product list component gets rendered. If you go into that child, the actual product route enter happens. And if you see this URL going back and forth, no, see the product route exited first, and then the product list products exit, and then the product list component get unmounted. Now I'll quickly run through from, so you are in products child, okay. If you see under products, there is one product and that product list is mounted. Now, if I go from here to teams, you can see product getting exited and then products exit, and then teams get the enter state, and then team list component get mounted, and then finally the destruction for product list. So we were moving from product list to teams. So these are the states it actually manages to run through. I was using nothing but these callbacks to actually print that console log. So these are the things happen in the transition. So there is a route and every route is mapped for a URL. Whenever there is a change in the URL, it is being observed. And then it will try to identify the route for that particular URL and identify the route. It will create a transition object. You must have seen the transition object in your model or before model hook. So the transition object is nothing but the from route, which is the current state, to the, you know, new state that we are moving in. So it constructs that transition route object, sorry, transition object, and then it initiates that transition. So when it initiates the transition, what it will do, it will exit the current route. So it exits the current route and queue the destruction model object, whatever that it has to clean up. And then it mounts the target object, I mean target route, which is there in the transition. And then it loads the model. The model must be loaded, right? Before rendering, loads the model. And then unmount the DOM will happen when it go and initialize the new component in the new route. And then render and point, paint and just repaint will happen. And then finally the destruction will happen. It will clean up the object. That's pretty much I have. Any questions?